Alrighty, I'm Carrie Wilson, and this is the Algebra 1 Math PLC. I was supposed to have done this in August, but had to reschedule a couple of times, and so we're finally getting to do Algebra 1. So if you're an Algebra 1 teacher, you're gonna love this. And if you're Algebra 2, I'm sure you could bump up the level of the math here and the practice or the problems that you do with the kids, and it'll work great in Algebra 2 class as well. Now, if you're a geometry teacher like I am, I teach geometry in Jamestown, Tennessee, high school geometry. You can definitely change this over to geometry standards if you wanted to. But for today, I've tried to keep it within the Algebra 1 standards. I won't have you sign in, so I'll just go on to the next slide here. Here is my email address. This is my school email address, so please feel free to reach out to me if you would like these slides and the resources that go with these slides. I will be more than happy to send these to you if you would like to use them in your classroom. And you can also change them to fit whatever you want to do in your class and make it work for your classes. So that is C. Wilson at YAI Dragons with an S.com. If you forget the S, I will not get the email. Alrighty, so here are the standards, and I like to try and make these PLCs overlap with science, and you could also probably pair this with a nursing class, this particular lesson, since it has to do with viruses and viral packaging. Again, this was supposed to be taught in August, and so it was going to fit right into all the COVID stuff going on as we go back to school. But anyways, for Algebra 1, the standard that we'll be hitting is distinguish between situations that can be modeled with linear functions and with exponential functions. So I've bolded linear functions, but you could leave that up for students to decide once they do the activity with this lesson. And you know, if you're doing a line of best fit in Desmos, that's the calculator that I like to use the best. You could let students decide, and then they could argue. Is it linear or is it exponential? So that would be a great way to do this lesson. Then for biology 2, this falls under immunology. The student will investigate the reaction of causes for and results of the immune response. So that kind of goes along with the reading that I put with the lessons and with all of the lessons. So for Algebra 2 and geometry that we did the last two PLC meetings, there is a reading excerpt that you could, you know, do in your math classroom, or you could give to the participating teacher. It would be great if you could have, you know, another teacher working with you. And then again, like I said, even pair it with the nursing class, and they would probably have a great time with working with you on this. And I think the kids would be able to better transfer the knowledge and retain it too. All right, so number one. I was hoping to have some people here today, so my number one fan is here today. I'll put you to work. So let's start with the directions, and we'll play with the supplies. The introduction video is how I'll get you started, and then we'll read the short excerpt that I have for today's lesson. So here we go. I think I already pulled it up. Hold on, so we don't have to watch the advertisement. Here it is.
In December of last year, doctors in Wuhan, China had a mystery on their hands. People in the region were coming down with an unusual pneumonia. It's cold and flu season, but these people didn't have either. Doctors quickly realized it might be something entirely new.
Medical nightmare, the coronavirus outbreak, never seen before coronavirus.
The number of confirmed cases in China keeps soaring.
Already 45 cases, 200 cases.
There are more than 6,000 confirmed cases. But so far, this outbreak has gone differently from others in the past. Thanks to the latest in biotechnology, scientists have been able to unravel the mystery at remarkable speed. They're revealing the biology of the new virus more quickly than ever before, and they're hoping it's fast enough to help drive back the disease outbreak. Chinese officials told the World Health Organization that it had an outbreak of some kind of virus on December 31st. By January 7th, Chinese scientists figured out that the virus was a coronavirus.
That's from the same family of virus as SARS, which emerged in China in 2002, and MERS, which infected people in the Middle East in 2012. The next step in understanding the new virus was sequencing its genome, figuring out the unique order of nucleotides, genetic building blocks, that make it up. The new coronavirus genome looks like this. It's just under 30,000 bases long. The coronavirus is made of a type of genetic material called RNA, but scientists convert it to the more recognizable DNA to make it easier to study. That's what you're seeing here. By January 13th, less than a week after it was identified, scientists in Shanghai had mapped out the entire genetic sequence of a virus sample collected from a patient. Compare that with the SARS virus, which started infecting people in November 2002. It took until April 2003 before that virus was sequenced in its entirety. And at this point, we don't just have one genetic sequence for the new coronavirus. Scientists have collected and sequenced nearly 24 samples of the virus collected from different patients. Researchers say the speed has been unprecedented. A lot of important things become possible once experts have this full sequence of the virus. Notably, that blueprint can end up in a place like this.
Yeah, I mean, this is the exact typical order we get. It's a bunch of A, C, G, and T. And for us on our machine, we can print anything. So if you want hemoglobin today, we can print hemoglobin. If you want chicken DNA, if you want coronavirus DNA, we can do it.
Twist Bioscience is a biotech company in South San Francisco that builds custom DNA to order. As the coronavirus outbreak progresses, scientists around the world are turning to companies like Twist to build copies of viral genes for urgent study, and they're sending in lots of orders.
We expected that there would be a number of demands for variants of the coronavirus to help in that discovery of drugs, vaccines, and diagnostic kits. And whatever comes from the web tonight, we'll start making tomorrow.
Custom-built DNA has been around since the 1980s, but the technology has gotten dramatically cheaper and easier since then. So researchers today have a lot more DNA at their disposal than they did during the SARS or MERS outbreaks.
If you go back to 2000, it would take $10 for make one base of DNA. In 2010, it would make $1, so 10 times more. And today, it's 9 cents per base, so again, 10 times more.
That's important because this kind of research requires a lot of trial and error. So the more copies of a gene scientists have, the better.
So it's biology. And in biology, it almost never works on the first time. You have to take a lot of shots on goals to get there. We give people the opportunity to take more shots on goals faster. And that way, they can get to that answer faster.
There's a few things scientists do with this genetic material. It can help create tests to screen patients for the virus. It can help researchers understand how the virus works and what it does to cells in the body. And crucially, it could be used in the development of vaccines. One important note, even though companies like Twist are churning out copies of the coronavirus genome, there's no concern they'll accidentally start an epidemic. They're not actually making the virus.
I think one thing that people should remember is that nature is the biggest bioterrorist. You know, nature wants to kill you, and that's what happens with the coronavirus. So the virus is out there, the sequence is out there. So we are not creating more virus, we are making fragments of the virus to researchers in order to enable them to find tools to detect it and tools to fight it.
The coronavirus is still a fast-developing public health crisis. It'll be a while before we fully understand its health impact, and longer still before there are treatments or vaccines available to fight it. But thanks to the progress in DNA tech, we have a greater head start than ever before. Thanks so much for watching. If you're interested in learning more about the coronavirus, check.
So this video, if you look at the date down here, was posted February 11th, 2020, so that was, I think, right as the testing was coming out for the coronavirus. And again, this was meant to be done back in August, so apologize for the lateness of this lesson. Anyways, let's go back to the PowerPoint. So I'm going to switch over to the handout that I've made with the reading. Here we go. So I've called this lesson viral packaging, and of course you need to have a virus to package it. And the students will actually make their own virus themselves, just like they were talking about in the video, and then they'll mathematically model the size of the virus and all that. So here's the title, and I pulled this particular article from News ELA. And so here we go. A 17-year-old creates coronavirus tracking website and has over 40 million views. And this is a picture of that tracking website. In the third grade, he coded a website with stick figures. In middle school, he coded video games. Now at age 17, Avi Schiffman has coded a highly trafficked website that tracks cases of COVID-19, also known as the coronavirus. COVID-19 is a respiratory illness that first emerged in December 2019 in Wuhan, China. Schiffman, who lives in Seattle, Washington, coded the coronavirus tracking website ncov2019.live when there were fewer than 1,000 cases in China. Since then, it has spread to more than 165 countries, which that's higher now, with more than 250,000 cases, which is also higher now. On March 11th, the World Health Organization officially characterized coronavirus as a pandemic. I think this is the first big world event for our generation, Schiffman said. It's kind of crazy how this is such a big world event that's completely changed everything from the economy to football games. However, despite the increase in COVID-19 cases, finding reliable, current statistics about the disease was difficult. I noticed it was just really hard to find anything that was happening, Schiffman said. I thought I could make something better than what the governments were doing, so I made a website. His website provides the latest data on the number of confirmed cases, serious cases, deaths, and people who have recovered, both worldwide and in individual countries. The site also includes an interactive Google map, travel advisories, and information on the disease and its prevention. Schiffman, who also competes in ski races and hackathons, is a self-taught coder. Everything I know is from watching YouTube videos and reading things online, he said. Schiffman uses web scraping to retrieve the data for his website. By using web scraping, Schiffman can download data from government websites and automatically have the data update on his site every couple of minutes. He uses reliable sources like the World Health Organization and the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention for the site's data. However, Schiffman said that these sources don't always present information in a quick, easy to understand way. It's maybe about every day they'll upload a PDF, and you have to download that PDF, and then you have to sort through all the complicated scientific things and look over a whole report, Schiffman said. I just want to see the numbers easily on my phone. I think most everybody would agree with that. Being able to view coronavirus statistics easily is beneficial for everyone, but especially for young students, Jody Wong, a PhD student at the University of Buffalo in New York, said that she refers to the website now and then. It's particularly useful for researchers like myself who study risk in science communication, Wong said. The site has gotten more attention than he expected. As of March 2020, over 40 million people have visited Schiffman's website. On March 16th, he posted on his Twitter that he relocated the site to a larger server to compensate for all the traffic. It has been visited by every single country on the planet by now, he said. Schiffman said that before his school was shut down because of the pandemic, he saw students and teachers using it. He also said a lot of news organizations use it to get their numbers. I'm only a teenager, but I'm able to provide a data source that millions of adults and massive places use, Schiffman said. To help the site improve, Schiffman welcomes emails from people who have suggestions or feedback about the site. But due to the site's popularity, this sometimes means he receives over 1,000 emails a day. Lila Schroff, 18 years old, met Schiffman in early March during an interview for their school's radio station. She was impressed by his hard work, but could tell he was overwhelmed by the popularity of the site, so she offered to help him with media-related tasks. Avi has done everything to make the site happen, and it's so impressive to see it unfold from behind the scenes, Schroff said. He is hardworking, passionate, and genuinely cares about making the world a better place. Schiffman said that he has been offered help from computer-related professionals but prefers to work solo. To be honest, a lot of the things I can do myself, he said, but it's great that I have the opportunity to connect with them. Although he has been offered internship and job opportunities at just 17 years old, Schiffman said he doesn't code just for the attention, but simply because he likes it. If you like art, you would use a paintbrush. I like making things. Instead of painting, I can type a bunch of random words and bam, there's a coronavirus website, Schiffman said. For other teams who might be interested in learning to code, it doesn't necessarily mean self-teaching from YouTube videos, as Schiffman did. Starting small is the key. Think of simple projects to work on, Schiffman said. Let's say you want to start learning how to make a website. Maybe make a complicated to-do list. Schiffman's own to-do list includes continuing to update his website with more data and graphs as users share more ideas with him. For instance, on March 22nd, a feature was added to the site that shows the daily increase in COVID-19 cases and deaths in easy-to-read percentages. But he is also considering expanding his skills to other issues too. His coronavirus website, he said, might turn into a tracker for a variety of things because of his interest in humanitarian projects. He recently bought the domain Germ Tracker, so he can be the first one to track other pandemics or even other world events. The Australian fires weren't necessarily a germ, but that is something that is very interesting to track. I'd like to make a lot more things. I know that he is very focused on the site in the present, but once COVID-19 eventually blows over, I can't wait to see all the amazing ways in which he changes the world, Schroff said. If you just put your mind to it, you can change something like what I did, Schiffman said. You just have to have the motivation to want to change the world. And so, you know, if you have students read this article, they could take notes right down here, or, you know, they could highlight what they like up here or make notes in the margins. However you would like to do it as the teacher, you might suggest that to your students. Also, I have been doing with my students readings on Wednesday at the beginning of the block. I stand by the door and pass out the article that my in-class students are reading, and it is already loaded on Google Classroom for my remote learners. And so I have everybody, I have an article for everybody to use. And I told the kids the first week, one of the students needs to be in charge, and I wrote their name on the board. And that student tells the other students who's going to read. They could read a paragraph, they could read a sentence, whatever the student in charge wants them to read. So like for this first, for this article here, it was kind of long, but he would definitely get all of the students to read. Because it's quite a long article. Some of the articles on the other ones that we've done were really short, and so it just kind of depends. One of my classes modified how they do it. They have the one student in charge start the reading, and then that student calls on the next student, and that student reads, and then when he's done reading, he calls on the next student, and the last student is in charge for the following week, and we just write their name on the board so that we can keep track of who's in charge. And seriously, as soon as the bell rings, three of my four classes start right then and there. I don't even have to tell them. The fourth class, I do have to remind them quite often. They're not as motivated probably as the rest. Also, they miss quite a bit. Being fifth block, they tend to leave as soon as they possibly can. And so it's hard to get them into a habit like my other three classes. So have fun with it. And the students start talking. And that's the best part. It's been hard to connect with students this year, and find that right article and they will start talking. And if you're willing to listen to what they say, that conversation won't stop. And it's good to have students talking right now, especially maybe over something like this topic. You can really get to know your students a whole lot better and hear what they're thinking. And who knows, it might really help a student to talk about the stress of COVID right now and how they're going through it. So I know you're just a math class, but it's good to take time to know your students and learn as much as you can about them, okay? Here's a little learning note that I added in this one. Without complete cellular machinery, coronaviruses cannot reproduce on their own. Unlike bacteria, which can multiply inside or outside your body, A virus has to infect a living cell to make more viruses. This means any coronaviruses that happen to get on a surface will inactivate over time, and that the most likely way to get infected is through direct contact with an infected person. So this activity that we're going to be doing is with a triangle to model the coronavirus. It's not exactly like the coronavirus, and kind of like they were talking about, there's many different versions of the virus that they're trying to replicate and study, and we're just going to do our own version. So down here in the directions, let me go back to my slides and make sure I don't have anything else. There is a thing right here. So let me put on this video right here so before we go into the activity, because that was the order in which we should be doing that. So you've read the article, you watched the introduction to kind of get the kids talking and interested in this, and here's the last video before we get started on the activity. I hope we have sound. I don't know what happened to the sound. It's up all the
computer.
What do I have to do? Sorry.
You have to flip on the screen, little thing to
open. Yes, make this thing bigger. Where's that button? What are you doing? I did it just a few seconds ago. I don't remember where it's at. I never do. I'm so sorry.
Oh, it's in the thing.
Oh, in here.
And then
you
PC.
Sorry. I thought my slides were back up here.
No, because you were showing this one.
Thank you. So all you teachers at home, I know you're suffering with technology, so do I. All right, let's try the video again. Okay, present, there's the button. Now I hear it, the little scratchy sound.
Have you ever wondered why scientists have such a hard time battling viruses? Well, it turns out that viruses have very strong, simple shells called capsids that they use to store all of their information in. In this experiment, called viral packaging, we're going to try and make some capsids of our own.
For this project, you will need some sturdy cardstock or other heavy paper for printing the provided triangle template onto. You can find the template at howtosmile.org, and each sheet of 8.5 by 11 inch paper will give you 2 templates to use. In addition, you will need around 3 feet of yarn, and about a half dozen cotton balls, and some tape for each of your experimenters. You'll want to have a pair of scissors handy so that you can cut out your templates, and optionally, you might want to have some crayons or markers for coloring your capsid proteins. Once you have all of your materials gathered up, we can try to solve the problem that took the microscopic virus millions of years to develop. A virus protects its information with strong armor made from tiny pieces of protein. First, grab your crayons or markers and begin to color your triangle template. Viruses try to make each piece of their armor identical. It's much easier to repeat a pattern than it is to come up with new ideas each time. Once your template is finished, cut out each of your triangles and begin taping them together. Remember that we're working with scissors, so you want to make sure to be very careful. Once you've cut out all of your triangle pieces, we're going to begin taping them together. We're trying to make the strongest capsid that we can to hold the most information possible. Now, just before you finish taping your virus closed, go ahead and leave an opening, which we'll call a lid, and we can insert some cotton balls in, as well as the yarn from earlier. Scientists sometimes call the capsid an envelope, and inside it, they find DNA, represented by the yarn, and protein information, represented by the cotton ball. When your model is complete, you can tape it closed, or leave it open so you can easily see how much information you were able to fit inside. With each of your models, take a look at their shapes. See if you can identify symmetry. For instance, with this shape, we We have an icosahedron, or a 20-sided shape with triangles. In this shape, there are actually three axes of rotational symmetry. For instance, when you look at it this way, and then flip it 180 degrees, it looks like the exact same shape. Can you find any other axes of symmetry in this shape? How many axes of symmetry are in the capsid that you made? Scientists today use these processes of the axis of symmetry, as well as opening the capsid shell, in a process called gene therapy, which they crack the different arms of the virus open so that they can insert information and make the viruses easier to fight. This is a very large area of research now, and it's very important.
Now that you've solved the problem that viruses had to solve in protecting and replicating their information, maybe you might try doing this experiment again using different shapes. For instance, you might try mixing squares and triangles. Is this more difficult to produce? Try to make shapes that hold the largest volume of data possible.
So that,
have you ever wondered
oops.
Why scientists have such a hard time?
Sorry. That's what we're going to be doing today, except we're going to try and put as much, here we go, information into our different shapes inside different capsules as we possibly can. So I'm going to flip back to the camera and remember that it's on the camera this time. And I guess I'll need to zoom in just a little bit, and I remember how to do that. There we go. So here's the table. And what I would do is I would know where my students were at and probably give my lower level students the first three, and then give my middle group maybe two or three of these, and then my upper group, you know, the bottom three or the bottom two, depending on what you wanted to do. You don't want to completely stress out your top kids, and you could probably mix up maybe 4, 16, and 20 sided shapes. But you are going to give them the pieces to cut out, well, to color and then cut out. I'm not going to color them, but you could cut them out. And here is a thought as you're cutting them out or having students cut them out, is instead of cutting out each piece individually, it might be possible that they could keep three triangles together, or, you know, two triangles together, so that it might be easier for them to put their capsule together. Now, that's for the bigger capsules. I wouldn't do that necessarily with the smaller capsules. They could tape those together, no problem. But if they kept the pieces together, they could just fold instead of having to retape the pieces back together, if that makes sense. So if they're just folding, that might be just a little bit easier on some students to fold and then tape on a couple pieces here and here versus having to cut each piece in separately. So like the tetrahedron, I would need a piece here and a piece here, I think. And a second thing I would do is let students be on their Chromebooks or whatever technology that they have available in your classroom to look up these shapes, because they do need to do a little research. Surely they don't know what all of these look like, if they know what any of these look like. I might even need to look up a couple myself, and I'm the geometry teacher, so it would be good to have students do research on these shapes. And again, I'm not coloring them, but have students color. It's kind of therapeutic. But anyways, you could just tape the piece right there, and then you tape the piece right here as your lid, and then you can stuff in the cotton ball, which I'm going to say on this particular one, the tetrahedron, I bet you could not even get a cotton ball in there, but you could tear a cotton ball maybe in half and then put in your 3 feet of yarn, because that's what he suggested to use. And so this might all be three, but this would have different numbers as the size of the shape goes up. Or you could have students maybe decide, since this is four-sided and he had an icosahedron, boy, I can't talk today, have them decide, well, if this is 20-sided and it gets 3 feet of yarn, this is four-sided, how many feet of yarn? So you could do a little ratio right there and have students figure out what the length of yarn should be. So there's a lot of different math applications you could do with this table and having them fill out how long the length of yarn should be, and then they would need to gently pack in the cotton balls, because as you can see, this is a little flimsy when you put it together, and so students would have to be careful. But again, I highly suggest that, you know, they could do three pieces together and fold and get their shape together. That way they're not having to tape all these little pieces together. The second troubleshooter I would do, especially if you have an inclusion class like mine, these are really tiny triangles. Let's see, that's an inch. So that's about an inch and a quarter right there along that side. So about an inch and a quarter on each side of this equilateral triangle. It's really tiny. And for my inclusion kids, it's just too tiny for them to handle. So I would take in the pruner and enlarge this one side right here so that students can work with bigger pieces, especially the inclusion kids. Now my, you know, honors classes, I'd make them work with these little pieces just because, you know, they're a little bit better at handling equipment. Some of my inclusion kids, not so much. Now, you know, I do have one honors kid that is football sized. He's fun sized. He might have trouble with these small pieces, so I might make him a bigger size as well, simply because his hands are huge and just holding these little tiny triangles, he might get frustrated. And I don't want to frustrate the kids. I really want them to have fun with this lab. Just realize if you make these bigger, those children have to color more. So maybe have them work in groups of two, you know, and pair them based on ability and have them help each other get this put together. And definitely give them enough to do each one of these. So if you're assigning these bottom three, they could definitely get that done with maybe one column, because that's less than 20 right there. So just, you know, put that math together. So once all the kids have their information filled in here, obviously everybody will have the same length of yarn measured in feet, but not all the kids will have the same information here. You could pull this easily, but over here you might suggest an average of the different groups that had the different shapes, and you could average in the number of cotton balls that they used. So I forgot a pen. Let me see if I've got one over here. I should. I usually have all my stuff out, but I forgot to get out a pen. There we go. Alrighty. So, just real quickly here, this is a quarter length of that, and a quarter of three would be, I don't know. I don't have a calculator. I don't want to do it. So let's say 0.75, I don't know. 1.5. That would be three right there at 16. So it's a little less than 0.75. I'll just stop mine at 16 here and cross out the icosahedron. And then, you know, fill in the information in between. But I've got 3 points, and that might be enough to do. And then I don't remember how many cotton balls we got in there. But the volume of these cotton balls, I don't remember being linear. So I'm going to pretend like it's not linear. If you get a linear, it was linear, sorry. I remember it being linear, not exponential, sorry. But anyways, you know, just put in their information and let's see here. This is halfway in between. 1.25, 1 and I should not have done ugly numbers. I should have done 4 down here. But anyways, just, you know, fill in the numbers as best you can. I'll just put in fake numbers. How about that? That would be easier. So 3, 2.5, 2, 1.5, 1.5, and let's say 0. This poor tetrahedron doesn't have any DNA. And this can be 3.5. And this can be 8. And this can be 9. So that would give you a linear model when we go to the Desmos. So let's just pretend that's our information, because I know that's linear. And this is assigned on the slide. I'll go back to the slide. For real this time. There we go. And you could do groups like this, you know, in groups of two, and it's already assigned for you. So it's entirely up to you how you want to do it. and you'd fill in the data sheet. And I'm trying to get to Desmos, so I'll just escape my slides here and go to Desmos. So I use Desmos for everything in the classroom, and I know that there's graphing features on the TI Inspires that we have, but I don't think TI Inspires are that user-friendly, and the kids do enjoy using Desmos quite a bit because they can pull it up on their phones and use it at home, and they don't have the TI Inspires at home. I do agree that they need to know how to use a TI Inspire for the ACT and those tests and stuff, but they'll figure it out, especially when they get to see it on a bigger screen like the Desmos. So anyways, I'm just doing really simple numbers, and that's easy to do. But I mean, you know, you can look at this. Of course, the kids' information will not be as pretty as this at all, but you can do a regression on this. So let me think here for a second. I think it is Y. Gotta figure out how to do my sub one. Where's the sub one? I think I just copied and pasted it up here. There we go. And it's a regression, so it's not equal, it's about. So you have to use the little assimile mark. MX, don't forget your B, your Y intercept. And you know, that's how they can pull up their regression. And of course they can do this with an exponential formula. Just make sure you use the little assimile mark instead of the equal sign, and they could see which one would fit better in their data set. And of course you could pull that up if you wanted to. Let's see if I can remember what the exponential formula looks like. I haven't taught Algebra 2 in a while. Let's see here. I think it's AB. So I could keep the X. I just need to square it. Oops. That made it quadratic. What did I do wrong? Oh, X goes up here. This is AB. There we go. I think this should be AB. There we go. There we go. And I don't think we need to have the B there. Alrighty. So again, students could compare. And if their data does look more exponential, that's okay too. I mean, you're in Algebra 2. It's good to compare between the two. And it might be that you want to have separate students' information up there instead of combining everybody's like we would, you know, normally. And maybe some students have an exponential graph versus a linear, and it's just good for students to talk about it and compare their results. So from the Desmos, I learned this from the chemistry teacher in our school. She has all these whiteboards. She has students write, transfer the information from the computer onto a whiteboard, and she has a lot of different formats for them to write, so that she has the graph, she has a paragraph explaining what's going on in the graph, there's a paragraph of research talking about what they have graphed, and then a place for their argument. So there's a lot of different ways that you could have students, you know, represent their work. And she has students do like a gallery walk to, but it's just one student in each group, to talk to the other students about their graphs. So there's a lot of different ways that you could do this. I tend to do it as a whole class group so that I can pull this up on Desmos for them, at least the very first time, to let them see how regression might work and how they could talk about the data and look at the data and even argue about the data. You know, some students might think it should be exponential. I don't know why they would, because this data is so pretty, but it might just be that way. So. It is not a hard activity. I think the hardest part is coloring. Some students don't like to color, but it's up to you how you want to do this. And again, working in groups of two, I would highly recommend. I would not have one student do a tetrahedron and one student doing triangular pyramid. I would definitely have two students working on this very consistently. All right, let's go back to the slides. Here we go. And since there's nobody here doing this particular experiment, it does take quite a bit of time. I have an hour and 10 minutes in a block, And so I might have a biology teacher introduce this concept in this lab, and they come in and I have the activity ready for them. They might watch that 5-minute video before they get started, but I would definitely have everything ready for them to go in an hour and 10 minutes. If you have an hour and a half block, that's more than enough time to introduce things, talk about things, and get them started in the activity. But 45 minutes, you're gonna have a hard time to get this done. So you definitely wanna either introduce it the day before or have another teacher working with you to introduce it. All right. Here's the conclusion video. I know I had a lot of videos on this one, sorry, but they were just fun looking up all these videos. This one's really short.
The World Health Organization was informed of an outbreak of pneumonia of unknown cause detected in Wuhan, China, on the 31st of December, 2019. Today we know that the infectious agent was a virus of the coronavirus family, which was named SARS-CoV-2, that causes a respiratory disease termed COVID-19. This virus has not only received widespread media coverage, but also caught the attention of scientists who have been busy analyzing the virus, the disease it causes, and how it spreads. There's already an enormous amount of information available about the virus, and that is why we thought to summarize some of the information in this video. First of all, what do we know about the virus? Coronaviruses receive their name from their appearance in electron micrographs, where the pronounced spike-like protrusions create the effect of a corona, Latin for crown. The genetic material inside the coronavirus is RNA, and the entire genome is almost 30,000 bases long, packed together with a nuclear protein into the viral particle of the RNA. For the virus to replicate, however, it needs to insert its RNA into cells and hijack the cellular machinery to produce new viruses. On its surface, the virion contains three main proteins: the envelope, the hemagglutinin esterase, and the spike protein. These are embedded into a lipid bilayer. The large spike protein is responsible for the crown-like protrusions, but it also recognizes the corresponding receptors on human cells called ACE2. The protease ACE2 mediates the cleavage of the spike protein, which then releases an epitope, enabling the subsequent fusion of the virus with the human cell.
So I know this one was a more technical video, but it kind of recalls back to the first video that we watched where they were talking about creating the virus to study the virus. Why would we do that activity that we did with the kids? You want to get to know everything you can about the virus, especially how much is compacted in that small little teeny tiny capsule, you know, and that would be a starting point to start studying the virus. And so this kind of brings to light the functions of the different parts that we, you know, really simplified for our short lab. So that is our conclusion video. I'm gonna go back to the slides. There we go, whoops. So, you know, just as a quick thing for students to think about a little bit more and maybe even extend what they know about this, have them take a moment, write down on a sticky note one statement that stuck with you, you know, about this lesson, two statements or questions you wonder about from this lesson, and three words that describe how you feel. And I would say that the three words might be the most important part, because you never know where the student's thoughts might be in their mental state. So you definitely want to be aware of bringing up the coronavirus. Maybe they're feeling anxious about this, or maybe their parents are feeling anxious and that, you know, feeds or rubs off on them and they feed off of that. So just be aware of where your students are at, especially as they're walking out of your classroom. You really don't want them to go home and tell their parents, oh, we learned about the coronavirus and it's actually, you know, okay, and or maybe it's not okay, and I don't know. You just want to be aware of how they're feeling. All right, so I've been doing a mathematics extension on all of these PLCs that we've been doing. So this is the modeling that I talked about before, and I've just forgotten that I made a special section just for it. So from your table, go to Desmos. Look at me go. I already had it nicely labeled for you. But anyways, you can label everything. And instead of doing X sub 1 as being this column, you could do it over here. So the sides of the capsule could be your input, and the next two columns could be your output. So you could get two different models if you wanted to. And then here is my references. I'm not that creative. I try to find things and then modify to fit the PLC for you guys. And I don't know why New ZLA is not up here. I guess because I referenced it on the handout itself. So New ZLA is where I got the article as well. And that is it. Again, I'm going to go back to the main slide that has my email on it in case you want to email me for these slides and the resources that I've shown you on the projector. Thank you. Yay! My number one fan.